Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 23, verse 1 to 6. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lay down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. A very good morning to all you wonderful people out there. I greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and I wish to welcome you to our worship service this morning. Truly, what an honor and a privilege it is for me to come into your homes and just share the Word of God with you this morning, and also that we can have a wonderful time of fellowship as we've gathered just to praise and worship Almighty God. Let us respond to that wonderful call to worship, but also I think an all-time favorite passage of scripture, Psalm 23. But let us respond to that with singing this morning as we praise and proclaim that our God is almighty. Let us join together in singing, "Come, now is the time to worship."
One day every tongue will come. the Lord
come. Let us all come before the Lord in prayer. Come, let us pray. Gracious Lord and Heavenly Father, loving and almighty God, we greet you this morning, Lord, as we've moved into your presence just to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and our King. And yes, Lord God, as the Father, you are the one that resurrected him, and you are the one that sent him to save us from ourselves, from our sin, and from a destiny of deprivation and one of hardship. Dear Lord God, we've come to celebrate his resurrection. So Lord, we pray this morning that our worship and our praise will be acceptable to you, and that you will receive each and every one of us this morning, Lord. But Lord, as we come proclaiming that you are the Lord of Lords and Jesus the King of Kings, we also need to realize that in a week gone by we have sinned against you, and that we need to confess our sins. So, dear Lord God, we pray that in our silence now, you will hear our hearts as we empty them of all those transgressions. So, Lord, we pray, receive our personal and individual confessions now. Oh, dear Lord God, we've emptied our hearts before you, Lord, and we pray that you will remove those sins from us as far as the east is from the west, Lord, because, Lord, you've assured us that you will forgive us, Lord, if we do confess. Oh, Lord, you made the promise if we repent and turn from our wicked ways, you will forgive us. And this morning, Lord, once again we proclaim that we are by no means perfect, but we are forgiven. Oh yes, Lord, and it's through you and through the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, through his death and his resurrection, that we have been set free from the bondage of sin. Oh Lord, we worship you and we praise you. Oh Lord, we pray your presence in our service this morning, Lord, and we just pray that you will be with each and every one of us, and that you will hold us very tightly wherever we may be. Oh Lord, we pray this morning that where we are lonely, you will be with us. Where we are anxious, you will console us. And where we are seeking friendship, you will speak to us. So, Lord, we pray. In the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us continue to praise the Lord in song. Let us open our hearts and let our mouths just resound as we bring our praise to him this morning. We join together in singing, "Open the eyes of my heart, Lord."
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. I want to see you, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Come, let us hear the word of God this morning as we turn to our Bibles and we read from the Holy Scriptures. Our reading this morning is taken from 1 Peter chapter 2, reading verses 11 to 18. Dear friends, I urge you as foreigners and exiles to abstain from sinful desires, which wage war against your soul. Live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human authority, whether to the emperor as the supreme authority or to governors, who are sent by him to punish those who do wrong and to commend those who do right. For it is God's will that by doing good you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish people. Live as free people, but do not use your freedom as a cover-up for evil. Live as God's slaves, show proper respect to everyone, love the family of believers, fear God, honor the emperor. Slaves, in reverent fear of God, submit yourselves to your master, not only to those who are good and considerate, but also to those who are harsh. Folks, let us come before the Lord and let us ask him just to enlighten our minds and our hearts, so that we may understand the word he has given us this morning. Let us ask him to give us the wisdom also on how to put this into practice in our daily lives. So let us come before the Lord in prayer. Oh dear Lord God, as we have heard your word to us this morning, Lord, we gather about you as your friends to hear, to try and understand what it is that you are trying to tell us. Oh Lord, we pray that you will open our hearts and that you will open our minds so that we may understand what it is that is written in your scriptures. Oh Lord, we cannot understand your scriptures without your Holy Spirit, the guidance of your Holy Spirit, Lord, and how he opens our minds to understand this. But Lord, let us not only just understand your word this morning, but let us take it and learn from it and put it into practice. Oh Lord, we go through life, Lord, and without your word we cannot do anything, and therefore we need to learn from you every time we hear your word. Oh dear Lord God, as I bring your message to these your people, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you will use me as an instrument of communication, and that every word and meditation that flows from my lips will be your words and meditations, Lord, and that those will bring you honor and glory at all times. So, Lord, we pray, be with us now in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. This morning, we continue where we left off last week. We're still in the letter of Peter, and we I've just changed the chapter and we've continued. But Peter sends us beautiful instruction here, and it's time just to look at that. And what he's talking about here is relationships. Now, I'm sure all of you will agree with me that the quality of our life is very much determined by the quality of our relationships. We all know that if we don't have good relationships, our life is going to be pretty boring and pretty hard to live. And it is a life that we will live which will be very, very lonely. But if we have good quality relationships with friends, with family, our life is great. And our life is so much more interesting. And it lets us thrive in life. And life has a lot of meaning to it. We are no longer so lonely as what we've always been if we didn't have relationships. So Peter gives clear instruction, yeah, and he says that we must honor all people. Now, Honor means that we must respect and love all people. Now, I don't know how many of you have a lot of respect for all people. A lot of people don't have respect for a beggar, for example, or a tramp. In the Cape, they have a name for that. They call them bergies. Now, how many of us really and truly do honor people like that? In this instant, where Peter writes this letter, the ancient Near East is under the rule of the Romans, and the Jews feel like foreigners in the ancient Near East. And this is why Peter writes them, and he says to them, listen, you are like foreigners in this country, but honor everybody. Honor the person, honor your neighbor, honor the stranger, honor everybody, respect them, reach out to them and love them. Very often, this is where we fall flat on our faces because we don't always respect other people. You may say to me, John, but that's difficult to do that. Well, as a child, my parents always taught me as common courtesy is to respect everybody, no matter who it is that you are addressing, but you always show respect. Now, an English practice is, and especially in the Afrikaans society, I don't know if you've noticed, when they address somebody, if you're younger than that person, you would address that person as uncle or auntie. In Afrikaans, oom of tannie. And when we do that, we are exhibiting respect to those people because we just respect them for who they are, no matter if we know them or we don't know them. But by respecting people, you open a channel for communication and conversation with people. Have you ever noticed when somebody is not very polite to you? How does that influence your response to that person? Your response to that person is, you're thinking to yourself, you know what, I just want to talk to you and get finished because I want to go away from you because you are being arrogant and you're being rude and you are not polite to me. So obviously you don't respect me and therefore I don't want to be in your company. That's exactly how it is when we are addressing other people. Sometimes we address them in a manner which is not respectful and those people don't want to be in our company. Can you just imagine how they must feel when they do not get the necessary respect in life? You may also say to me, John, but you know, this thing of uncle and aunt is an old-fashioned thing. I want to say to you that ethics and manners and courtesy can never grow old. If you are kind and polite and respect people, people will respect you. Respect is not a given. Respect is earned. And therefore, if you respect other people, they will automatically respect you as well. Another thing that has crept up in modern day society is how we don't respect the authorities within our community. Yes, we may not agree with their actions and we may not agree with what they do in society, but the Bible, yeah, Peter writes, he says, we must respect all authority. In other words, we must respect the law, we must respect the ordinances, we must respect the governor, in our case, the president and the different ministers. Although we don't agree with them, although we have a difference of opinion, we must still respect them. And you know, by respecting them, we can always debate something with them or bring up our point of view. But without respect, there is no channel open. I want to say to you that I'm also one of the guilty ones. The Bible calls us to respect authority. In other words, we must respect the law as well. And I'm the first one that drives a little bit too fast and I break the law. But you know, when we do that, we are going against what Peter is saying here, and we must respect that. What he is saying is if the law says you must travel 60, we must travel 60. Not 65 or 66 or do what I do, I know there's a 10% grace, the speed traps, so I know if I travel 66, I'll still be safe and they won't stop me. But that is wrong. That is totally wrong, because the scriptures say to us, we must respect the law. I had a wonderful chat this morning with a very good friend of mine that said to me, you know, these regulations now that we have, in that if we go out into the public, we have to wear a mask. Oh, I don't like it, and it's so uncomfortable. So what I do is I just drop it and I don't wear a mask. I say to you, you may not agree with what they say about the mask or whatever the regulation determines. But because the regulation determines that, that is our authority. It's an authority over us. And we need to respect that. And Peter is very, very clear in saying that we respect all authority, no matter what. We respect that because out of our respect and out of our love, people will learn from us. They will see that we respect the law, we respect one another, and that we love one another, and they would soon want to follow what we do. We become role models in the lives of other people. Peter also says that we must have love for our fellow believers. Now, can I tell you, this is a very, very important point that Peter raises here. Because within the ecclesia, which means is a community of believers, how can there be unity amongst believers if there is no love amongst the believers? I've spoken very many times on we must love one another and we must continue that. But just think of that. If we are Christians and people are looking into our community of Christians, our ecclesia, our community of believers, what do they see what is going on if we don't love one another and respect one another? They see discord and they see everybody wanting to do their own thing. And then I wonder how they want to become part of something like that, because there's no love amongst believers. It is very clear that if we are in the body of Christ, we have to take hands and we have to love one another. I've very many times heard the saying, "Is I will love somebody, but I don't have to like them." Now, to me, that's again another thing. How do you love somebody but you don't like them? Because according to my understanding of love, love is a much stronger emotion than like. Without like, you can't love, and without love, you can't like. So this just does not make sense to me. So we have to reach out to one another, although we are different. And remember, I said each and every one of us have been created uniquely, that with all our differences and with all our uniqueness, we learn to accept one another with our differences, and we love one another unconditionally. So again, Peter says here, so that when people look at us, they see the unity, they see the love, and they use us as an example to further the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ. And also, Peter speaks out against the relationship amongst husbands and wives. Oh my golly, people, I have been snowed under with counseling with people that want to get a divorce. Because it's so easy nowadays, because there's no respect in that relationship of husband and wife. All you do is you go hop along down to the court, you fill in a form, and you know what? It is so quick nowadays to get a divorce. It is actually a joke. But if we respect one another and we love one another, and we continue our lives together, that bond of marriage, that bond of love. And we must remember here that every time Jesus refers to us and the relationship with us, he refers to us as his bride. And he uses the illustration of marriage between himself and us. And he even says on his second coming, he will be coming to fetch his bride. And we must stop and just think a little bit. What is it? Why is the marital bond so precious to Jesus? And it's because this is the display of ultimate love, an intimate relationship, a relationship that can never be topped by any other relationship. So I want to say is, last week I spoke about reverence and respecting God. Today I want to say to you that you must respect your spouse so that that marital bond can be held together, so that love can flow freely between the two. How do you love somebody if you cannot respect that person? So the relationship between a husband and wife is so, so important. The last point this morning I want to touch on is that of morals and ethical codes within the community and within the household. You know, I'm shocked as I see what is going on within the community as well as within the household when it comes to ethics and moral codes and common courtesy and manners. Everything nowadays goes. You see, the ethical codes within community normally decide on the courts in how they enact in the different regulations. A classic example of this is what I've just spoken about on divorce. If you go back about 30 years or 20 years, to get a divorce was a very big thing, and courts did not take to that very lightly. And normally where you had a third party involved in a divorce, that person could be held liable for breaching of the family, for the breaking of the vows. And normally if you go to court, that person could be liable for a fine or to pay certain costs or certain expenses. And about 3-4 years ago, I was involved with a very good friend of mine that got a divorce. And this poor guy lost everything. And we said, but what about the third party that broke up the marriage? And the courts just said that today in society, it is okay to get a divorce. It is the norm. And therefore, the third party cannot be held liable for the breakup of that marriage. Now, folks, that is wrong. That is wrong. It's because we are allowing just earthly morals and ethics and manners to creep in to what is normal in our society today. We must just go back and think, where do these morals and ethics, where do they originate from? Where does it come from? And I want to say to you that originally it is all biblical ethics that were used. And the original Decalogue, the Ten Commandments, were used very heavily in constructing and starting moral issues within society. Nowadays, when we look at the morals and the ethics within society, we see the Bible as virtually non-existent within that. We see it's all things that take the norm of what society thinks is normal. And we need to stop that, and we need to come back to what the scriptures say, and we need to see what God says, and we need to live according to those morals and ethics. Because if we do that, then we will find that respect and honoring people will come back very quickly. Honoring your neighbor, honoring your wife, honoring the authority, honoring all relationships will come back into society, and then we will live the way the Bible, the way God wants us to live again. Folks, I have a challenge like I have for you every week, and this week I want to challenge you to go out and I want you to study What morals and what ethics do you follow in life? Have you just fallen in and agree with what society gives to us? Or do you live your life according to what the Lord gives to us? Once you've determined and found according to which norms and morals and ethics you live, I want you to compare that to the morals and the ethics that the Bible gives. And if they are not in line with what the Bible gives to us, I beseech you, and I know that's an old word, but I want to really, really ask you to change those morals so that they may be within the will and in the way and in the purpose that God has given to you. Amen. Let us respond to the word of God in prayer. Come, let us pray together. Oh dear Lord God, we want to thank you this morning for feeding us with your word, teaching us, Lord, what it is that you expect from us. Oh dear Lord God, we can only stand in awe when we look at you and hear your word to us. Oh Lord, as we've heard your message this morning, we just want to pray that you will help us to put this into practice in our lives, and that truly, Lord, we will honor everybody and respect everybody, respect the law, respect the stranger, respect our neighbor, respect our wives, and truly keep that relationship bond intact in all our relationships. Oh Holy Spirit, where we are inclined to go off the road and do our own thing, we want to pray that you will convict us, dear Holy Spirit, and that you will just bring us back to where you want us to be. Oh dear Lord God, we thank you that we can be your children. We thank you that you've adopted us into your family and that we are part of a royal priesthood. We are adopted by you, and we praise you and we worship you, and we can never express our gratitude enough to you, dear Lord God. Lord God, we thank you for today, but as we come before you, we want to ask you that you will be with our country. We want to ask you that you will be with everybody, Lord, where they've been confined to their homes, and that we don't have all that free movement like we have had in the past because of the coronavirus. And we want to pray this morning, Lord, that your will be done in our country and that you will take control of this virus and that you will bring us through it. Oh Lord, grant us the perseverance, grant us the strength, grant us the courage, so that we may continue our walk with you, no matter what life throws at us. So Lord, we want to pray and thank you that we can ask you for all these petitions, and that we can come to you knowing that you are our Heavenly Father. So Lord, we praise you and we worship you in the wonderful name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Folks, I don't know about you, but I love singing songs that bring praise and worship to Jesus and to our Almighty God. So this morning I want to say to you, come, let's do what I love, and I'm sure you love it as well. Let us praise the Lord in song as we join together in singing. What a beautiful name is the name of Jesus.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Jesus Christ.
As we conclude our service, receive now the blessing. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, here now today, and forevermore. Amen. Folks, time has come again to an end in being with you. I enjoyed being with you so much this morning, and it's been an honor and a privilege once again. So folks, as our time runs out, until we meet again, stay safe, stay well, and again I say to you, lean not on your own strength, but only on that of our Lord Jesus Christ. So until we meet again, goodbye now.
May the road rise to meet you, may the wind be at your back, may the sun shine warm upon your face. May the rain fall softly on your fields, and until we meet again, may you keep safe in the gentle loving arms of God.
For everything there is a season, a time for meeting, a time to say goodbye. In all things God's near, always guiding your way.
May the road rise to meet you, may the wind be at your back, may the sun shine warm upon your face, upon your face. May the rain fall softly on your fields, and until we meet again, may you keep safe in the gentle loving arms of God.
For everything there is a season, a time for laughter, a time for tears and pain. In all things God is near, always guiding your way.
May the road rise to meet you, may the wind be at your back,
may the sun shine warm upon your face,
may the rain fall softly on your fields,
and until we meet again, may you keep safe in the gentle loving arms.